Hi YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to have a chat about the GPS disciplined crystal oscillator. Now the one I've got here, the brand or the model is TrueTime. It's a TrueTime XLDC and it's made by a company called Symmetricom. So let me just warn you up front, this video is going to involve a bit of storytelling in terms of how I ended up with this device, and it's led me down several fascinating rabbit holes in terms of understanding what its uses are and how it works. So if you wanted that quick instant coffee hit on how this works, this might not be the video for you. I will add a timestamp over here to when I actually start getting into the more bare details of this and how it works. And when we get down to the bench. But I think there's a lot of value in kind of understanding timekeeping and what kind of led me to this device and why this device is so useful for timekeeping in general and potentially how it could be useful on your own bench. Now this I bought off eBay. I paid just under $500. And of course, for a lot of folks who probably don't understand or appreciate the value this can bring to their bench, $500 is a lot of money. However, if you get to the end of this video and you suddenly realize, wow, that would be really handy, there are other options. On the top here, I've got one that you can buy off eBay for less than $100. And although there are some cons to it, there are also some pros. It has some advantages over this bigger device. So I will demonstrate both of them, and then you can weigh up in your own mind, if you're interested, which one would potentially benefit you. Even if you're not interested in buying one, I think it's fascinating to understand what they can do and just timekeeping in general. Right, so what led me down this road? Now, at the start of this video, you would have heard a tone, and that tone was at 360 hertz. So what led me to actually purchase this device? Was I've been doing some research on wristwatches, and if you have been with my channel for a while, you know I do have an interest in wristwatches, in timekeeping. I have both mechanical watches, pocket watches, and although I have a few quartz watches, I recently wanted to do a bit more investigation into their accuracy. And as you'll see from the t-shirt that I'm wearing a Bulova Accutron Space View t-shirt, and I happen to own one of these. Now, if the camera doesn't focus, I will take a closer shot of this so you can see it. This piece is actually from 1970. It's the year I was born, so it's coming up for 48 years old. And I discovered this while I was doing some research on watches. It is the first wristwatch. It's the first electronic wristwatch, and it kept time by means of a mechanical tuning fork. And that tuning fork runs at 360 hertz. It's a beautiful piece of technology. It looks absolutely gorgeous. I was blown away when I discovered these. I have several versions. So before I even go into that, if you want to learn more about that Accutron Space View, because it's got an interesting history, it was used in space. NASA have used them for timekeeping because during the 60s, it was at that time the most accurate wristwatch atomic time was just being developed at that time as well. But it was, in terms of a portable timekeeping device, it was perhaps the most accurate at the time compared to mechanical wristwatches. Now Dave Jones, and I only discovered Dave's video after I purchased this, I think he actually owns one of these as well, and he did a really, really nice video review on this where he actually takes a high-speed shot and slows down so you can actually see the oscillation of the tuning fork that's in here. Now, as I said, if you put it to your ear, you can actually hear that tone through the back of the watch, or the front, in fact. Now, so once I discovered this watch and understood kind of the technology which had been brought about at the time, and we're going to go back in time and again cover this as we move towards accurate timekeeping pieces like this GPS disciplined crystal oscillator. I wanted to see how accurate other wristwatches were when they weren't having their time maintained from, let's say, the radio signal from Colorado, the atomic radio signal, or from satellites. Generally speaking, quartz watches, and that's what knocked out the Bulova tuning fork watch, was that this was kind of developed in the late 50s. It came, the public were able to buy these from about 1960 through to 1976. But in 1969, as I recall, it was Seiko that brought out the first quartz crystal wristwatch. And that was, comparatively speaking, a lot cheaper and even more accurate than the Bulova tuning fork. Now this wristwatch, and I've seen various quotes, and I think they're misquotes. Some state that it kept time to within 2 seconds a month. I think the actual figure is within 2 seconds a day. But within 2 seconds a day, which this roughly does right now, it was far better than mechanical watches at the time, because mechanical watches only were able to do about 15 to 30 seconds plus or minus each day. Now, I have the more modern iteration of this. So Bulova have brought out, what they have is a higher frequency crystal, which they believe keeps more accurate time. So this is the Accutron 2. It's a scaled down version of their other movement called the Precisionist. And it runs at, if I recall correctly, 262 kilohertz. And that supposedly gives it better timekeeping. And that's something I'm trying to actually verify. It's very easy to get bowled over by these marketing claims that it's like eight times the frequency of a standard quartz crystal in a wristwatch, and therefore keeps better time. Now they claim this keeps time to within 10 seconds a year, which is absolutely incredible, because to purchase a wristwatch which does timekeeping that well, you can pay thousands, like $5,000-$6,000. Whereas you can get these Precisionist and Accutron 2 movements for anywhere between $100 and $300. So I'm checking out that claim as well as some other quartz wristwatches, and I wanted an accurate time reference. Now, of course, one could go out and get an atomic clock, and I have a couple of those, but they can sometimes struggle to get the signal. So it can be a challenge sometimes to have an exact reference. Yes, you can bring up the atomic clock on your computer, but I wanted something I could glance at. And even the atomic clocks, when they synchronize, sometimes they don't get the precise second synchronization, and that's what I was after. So I went and purchased this off eBay, and I discovered that it's got a whole lot more value in terms of being able to use it as a reference on the bench. So before we get into that, let's just understand the challenges of timekeeping and crystal oscillators and how they can be a real challenge when we're trying to do really precise time measurements. Right, so if we go back in time to understand a little bit of the history of timekeeping. Many, many years ago, they'd have used a stick in the ground, or they'd have used an obelisk to basically cast a shadow as a sundial to track the movement of the sun and therefore work out time from that. Things moved on, and the next method that was, one of the other methods that was used, was actually having water pour from a container through a particular size hole in it, and then obviously fill up another container, and they could mark time on that. The big change came, and I think it's in the 1700s, if I remember correctly, when the use of a pendulum came into being. And that was where the first use of an oscillating body was used to keep time. So you'd have a pendulum swinging back and forth, and that would swing in a sinus, in fact, like a sinusoidal pattern. And we're going to look at, I've got a board with something on it where you'll see how this 1 hertz sinusoidal pattern is developed by the pendulum swinging back and forth. Now, the interesting thing is, if you go and do any research on timekeeping, you will generally hear these methods mentioned, and then they skip from the pendulum through to the crystal oscillator. And they seem to miss the tuning fork, which is, say, it's why sometimes you just don't get to hear about Bulova and, for instance, the tuning fork wristwatch. But in fact, the tuning fork as a tool or instrument for understanding, let's say, a musical note or tone, was used back in the 1800s for timekeeping. And in fact, the first tuning fork clock was developed in around 1866, if I recall. Now, that was a mechanical clock, so it was wound up, and it oscillated the tuning fork. And I've seen multiple references, and one quotes at 62 hertz, the other quotes at 100 hertz. But basically, those oscillations were counted and then displayed on a dial. So that's where the kind of first tuning fork was used, and then we progressed on from tuning forks to mechanical movements in wrist watches, where you had a balance wheel swinging back and forth. And then we go on to the quartz crystal, and it was discovered because of the piezo effect. When you add a current to a quartz crystal, you can get it to oscillate. It'll then generate a pulse, and that pulse can be read, and you can then count those pulses and do timekeeping from that. And that's where the kind of quartz watch, wristwatch timekeeping comes from. So that quartz technology and those quartz oscillations and quartz crystals are critical to our digital electronics today. So basically, you're rarely going to find any digital electronics, ICs or what have you, that can operate without a quartz crystal or some form of timekeeping. You're going to have a time impulse which operates the input and clocking of an IC. And it can be used for that operation or timing on outputs or what have you. So things just wouldn't work without crystal oscillators. Now, for the most part, in many of our day-to-day electronics, the accuracy and precision, and remember, the accuracy and precision have two different meanings. So accuracy is how spot on you are to the right value, whereas precision is the amount of resolution you have to a certain number. You can be very precise but not on the right number, whereas accuracy describes how close you are or to the actual number you want. And that's where there's an interesting marketing term which Bulova have introduced, where they used to call their watches Accutron, the movement, and now you've got, for instance, precisionist, but that'll be for another video. But so these quartz crystals, sometimes you don't need them to be that accurate or even that precise in terms of the resolution that you need them to measure down to. But in some cases, it is critical. In our modern world, time has become such a big factor. And if we want to understand the kind of precision and accuracy that we need in something that probably most of you use and have heard about, and that's the GPS satellites, you will have some form of GPS location on your cell phone. You might use a GPS device in your car to help you find where you're going. And those GPS satellites need to have an accuracy of beyond, or at least down to nanoseconds and beyond, because if they don't have that precision and accuracy, their locating ability goes out by a huge amount. And things start getting very fascinating when you start looking at Einstein's theory of relativity and time dilation. Time passes at a different rate at the satellites versus us here on Earth. And so the time has to be constantly corrected on the timekeeping on the satellites so that we do maintain that kind of nanosecond accuracy for our accurate location here on Earth. And the great thing is that those satellites are keeping very accurate time, and we can use that, just as I've got displayed here, to actually control and keep a crystal oscillator on a particular reference frequency. So through this process, I've gone and read about and discovered a whole lot about crystal oscillators. And it's interesting to see the various types and the requirements to try and keep them as accurate and precise as possible. Now, in terms of maintaining accuracy, one of the key reference frequencies which is used for a lot of equipment is 10 megahertz. And that 10 megahertz can be used as a reference for your equipment on the bench. And to put this in some perspective, to understand how important timekeeping and accuracy can be, the oscilloscope on your bench can time things down to nanoseconds, picoseconds, and I think even down to femtoseconds. So it can go down to a very fine resolution. And inside, it's going to have a crystal quartz oscillator as a time reference for all its work. Now, in order to have good accuracy, you need to take very good care of a crystal oscillator, even though it's a reasonably robust device in a little tin can. Your standard crystal oscillator has very little protection from temperature changes or fluctuations and shock or gravity. And these are the things, G-forces, shock, and temperature changes can really influence a crystal oscillator. The other thing is just age. Crystal oscillators over time will slowly drift. And it's said that, and this is something I'm keen to go and test in my research, is that obviously over time, when a crystal oscillator ages, it becomes more stable. It'll stay on a particular frequency and won't drift as much once it's done some aging. But crystal oscillators do age, and thus their frequency is going to drift. And that can vary on the quality of the crystal. You can have different cuts of the crystal. Some of those will be better suited or more tolerant to changes in the environment and temperature. And then you also want to protect them from shock. So several methods are used to do that. You get digitally controlled crystal oscillators. You get temperature controlled or temperature compensated oscillators, where they'll have circuitry which will understand the environmental temperature changes and then adjust for that. Or you can have ovenized crystal oscillators, where they're literally in another tin can with a heating element to take them up to a certain temperature and to try and keep that temperature constant to keep their oscillations constant. You then get ovenized crystal oscillators, which are also in bigger housings where they've got dampening or shock absorbers. And these are typically used in, like, for instance, military applications in fighter jets, where they might be experiencing huge G-forces or shocks, and they're trying to limit that going to the crystal oscillator. Now, I also, off eBay, and this is, believe it or not, this frequency counter that I've got on my bench, was I bought off eBay, and after I did the transaction and it was sent to me, I discovered, and the gent realized, he was actually one of my viewers. So a big hats off to him. This is his own personal frequency counter, which he's kept in really great condition. But this frequency counter has both its standard crystal oscillator inside, but also has an optional ovenized crystal oscillator. And you can literally, in some cases, set jumpers to switch between the kind of standard oscillator that you get, and then, let's say, an optional ovenized crystal oscillator. You also get things like rubidium standards, we'll talk about those, and then a cesium standard. But I've already played around with calibrating this device, and the ovenized crystal oscillator is obviously far more stable at kind of maintaining that reference 10 megahertz frequency. But even though you have an ovenized crystal oscillator, I found that even breathing on it, because you're measuring down to, let's say, 10 to the minus 9, 10 to the minus 12, you're getting down to very fine resolution and splitting ball hairs. And when you're getting that fine a resolution, any small changes in the environment or shock can show up and flutter in those last digits. Also, aging. I will show you that when we get to the bench and we have a closer look at some of the frequencies and how these two GPS disciplined oscillators work, I will show you that even though I calibrate this right down to several digits down, it has already drifted within the last week. And it's not any fault of this device. That is literally, it is to the specification and the aging and drift of that ovenized crystal oscillator. So how does this potentially impact us on the bench? So as I mentioned, all these devices that you might have on your bench, you might have a frequency analyzer, you might have a frequency generator, a frequency counter, an oscilloscope, and they're all going to have their own crystal oscillators internally. And for the most part, they're not going to have very expensive ones. They're not going to have ovenized crystal oscillators or rubidium standards inside them, because that gets expensive. Not only that, when you switch them on, if you've got an ovenized crystal oscillator, it's going to take anywhere from 5 to 15 minutes for that oven to heat up and for it to be ready and locked at its frequency to start working. And for the most part, people want to be able to switch these on and start working reasonably quickly. So there are potentially inherent inaccuracies in all these devices. And if you think that you may be working on a critical electronics project and you are injecting a frequency from a frequency generator and you are measuring it with a frequency counter and an oscilloscope, and you may even have a frequency analyzer, all of them have got their own clocks, and all of them may be out by a certain margin, and all those margins or errors can compound and add up to give you a really bad situation in if you are trying to do something that's fairly critical and requires a reasonably good accuracy or precision down to a certain degree. So that's where having a good reference helps. So what can you do as a reference? So the one reference I mentioned already is a rubidium standard. Now I know Dave Jones did a video on this some time ago, and it's claimed that just him doing that video kicked up the prices of rubidium standards on eBay. But you can see why. In terms of a reference, they are really, really, really nice. The benefit of a rubidium standard, even though it may take some time to kind of warm up and lock into its reference frequency. Now, I've mentioned 10 megahertz. You can have other reference frequencies, but 10 megahertz is the most common. But once a rubidium standard has kind of locked in, its accuracy over a short period of time is really good. That accuracy, when you're talking about accuracy and stability over a short period of time, that is often referred to as an Allen deviation or Allen variance. And that's a kind of very short-term accuracy over 1 second, 10 seconds, or 100 seconds, or perhaps even a day. You then have drift or aging, and that is normally specified over a day, a month, or a year. And a rubidium standard works really well in both those counts. It stays accurate and it doesn't drift that much. And as I noted, if I wanted to do really accurate readings, even though this has an ovenized crystal oscillator, I would need to calibrate this every single day or every time I want to use it if I wanted it to be spot on to cater for its aging and that slight drift. And even if you had a rubidium standard, even that over time is going to drift. And in fact, Fluke, this exact frequency counter, this one is the PM6685. There is a PM6685R, and that has a rubidium standard in it. And even that has a trim pot on the front, so that you can go and calibrate that to a reference if you've got drift that you want to null out. So at this point in time, this is where the GPS disciplined crystal oscillator comes into play. So basically what this is a crystal oscillator, and again you can get various options. Like for instance, this True Time, you've got the standard crystal oscillator inside, which isn't ovenized. This one, which we will open up in another video, does have an ovenized crystal oscillator. You can also add a rubidium standard. In fact, you can even have an external cesium standard. So the cesium standards are what are used for really accurate atomic time, and that's what the 1 second SI standard is based on. And the beauty about these is even though you've got that oscillator which can drift over time, it's referencing the atomic time from the satellites to keep on calibrating, if you will. So it's automatically adjusting the trim pot via a DAC to keep it spot on frequency. So let's just talk about that. I'm going to now bring up a board and we'll talk about the kind of high level working of this, and then we'll get down to the bench and actually have a look at its operation. Right then, so before we kind of get down into some of the bare bones of a GPS disciplined crystal oscillator, let me just give you a few other examples or areas where this might be used, because it's certainly not just for the hobbyist bench. One example is, let's say, in the power generation field. There are certainly cases where, let's say in power generation, where they want to switch things, multiple devices, let's say multiple relays, they want to switch at exactly the same time. And it could be down to not just a second, it could be a millisecond, a microsecond. They want these things to switch. Now, if you had to have, let's say, one central point that you're going to push a button and switch, or one central clock which is going to switch and then send the signal to all the relays, if you're going down to that level of kind of accuracy and resolution, the cable length that you're sending that signal down will change the time that it's going to take for that signal to reach a particular device. And you can see this on an oscilloscope. For those of you obviously in ham radio or dual deal with RF, you'll know if you put two signals into the scope and you've got one of your leads is longer, you can actually see the phase difference. And if you've got time, I'll show you that to you on the oscilloscope. So in the power generation, they would literally have a device like this, a single reference which is getting very accurate GPS time, down literally to nanoseconds. Now, when I say nanoseconds, this device that I've got here was developed in the late 90s. It's from the late 90s or early 2000s when there was SA, or selective availability. So that was where the US government were introducing some flutter or some error into the GPS signal so that it wasn't as accurate, so that it couldn't be used for precise measurements. Now, that SA was taken out, which has made this device even more accurate today. But having that single point of reference, that could then be used to synchronize slave devices near your relay. So you'd have this as your single source. You'd then have slave clocks which reference themselves to this reference so that they then end up with accurate time. And let's say at 10 a.m. in the morning, precisely to the microsecond that they all needed to switch these relays, that can happen. The other interesting application, let's say if you wanted to do time measurement between two locations which are separated by a large distance. And here I'm going to go off on a little rabbit story which I found fascinating. So some time ago, a few years ago, and this relates to high frequency trading on the stock exchange. So if you don't know it, most of the trading on the stock exchange at the moment is done by computers and at very high speed, literally thousands of transactions per second. So when the switch over to, as I say, as opposed to guys sitting on the trading floor shouting their orders to computers doing this, traders realized that they needed to get their trades in very quickly. The first person in there potentially can get their trade processed. And for instance, there was some entrepreneur realized that the guys who were trading from Chicago, they were using links down to New York to the stock exchange. And basically, the time it took for their computerized request to issue a trade on the New York Stock Exchange would take too long, and that people closer to New York or in New York were getting the trades all the time and they were losing out. So he wanted to develop a high-speed link. So he went and literally paid huge amounts of money to have a fiber cable from Chicago go the most direct route. So as opposed to going the kind of easier route, which the existing cable went down, it went down the straightest route possible. And that only saved milliseconds. I think the figure is like 30 milliseconds, but it came down to like 3 milliseconds. So those milliseconds, by having those few extra milliseconds, he was able to beat traders in other locations. And he was able to sell the use of this link for billions of dollars. That's how critical it became. Things then changed up again. They then brought in, there were ruling people were then kind of, companies were renting spaces or offices as close to the stock exchange as possible. So their communication link to the stock exchange was that short. Now let's go back to measuring. How would you measure a difference of milliseconds over such a long location? And this is where you could get one of these devices in both locations, both synchronized exactly, and you can talk to these via a port, and as opposed to just seeing, let's say, 1 second increments on the front, you can get a timestamp out the back of it down to microseconds or even nanoseconds. And once you can do that, you can then have confidence in your timekeeping on both ends and see the delta or the difference and measure that really accurately. So that would be one use, is trying to measure something over a vast difference and ensuring that you've got precision and accurate time-synced devices or timestamps at either end. Now, further to the stock exchange, it came down to that basically they then had a server room inside for these trading companies. So everyone then had a server in a rack inside the stock exchange. And to make it fair, because it was a fairly big rack, there would be servers which are close to the point of the stock exchange or close point of entry, and you might have, I don't know, 50 feet or 100 feet away, the end of the server rack. They made the LAN cables all the same length, so that even the server closest to the point of the transaction didn't have an advantage versus one which might be 10 feet away or 100 feet away. And you may think, 10 feet away, does that make a difference? I've got two cables here, and even with a foot, 1 foot difference, you can see a phase difference between two signals. So yes, that's how critical timing comes down to on trading on the New York Stock Exchange. Right, so here I just want to demonstrate. So we basically coming from where we had pendulums swinging back and forth at a frequency of 1 hertz, going to a device that we've got here that is using cesium standards, going down to nanoseconds and beyond to retain accurate and precise timing. Now, even with a pendulum swinging back and forth, any shocks or even temperature change, a temperature change, let's say an increase in temperature, could elongate the pendulum and change the oscillation. Just like we have the temperature changing affecting the crystals inside a crystal oscillator. So how does this device work? So I've got a GPS satellite antenna just sat outside. In fact, I've got two, one for the cheaper device and then one for the Symmetricon device. And it is receiving signals from the satellites. Now, it can work off one satellite, but ideally you want at least three or four. It in fact only has a 6-channel receiver, which is fairly low tech. These days you're gonna find 12-channel receivers, and you're gonna find receivers which receive from the US satellite and GLONASS, that's the Russian satellites, to give you more options of seeing more satellites. And the more satellites you have, the more accurate and more quickly you can average your position. And basically that's what this device does. It needs to accurately establish its location, and then from that it can get good timing. Now the challenge with getting your timing from the satellites is you're only getting one pulse per second. And in fact this device also has an output. It's got an output for 1 megahertz, 5 megahertz, 10 megahertz, I've got in fact an additional 3 outputs for 10 megahertz, and then a 1 pulse per second. Now if you're trying to steer a clock that's operating at 10 megahertz, so that's 10 million hertz, but you're only getting a signal every 1 second, that's 1 hertz, that becomes a challenge. You're certainly not going to be able to adjust your crystal oscillator inside very quickly when you only operate getting a signal every 1 second. So that's the downside of this device. In terms of being able to fire it up and get short-term accuracy, you can't do that. And that's why I say potentially having a rubidium standard where you can switch it on, you may have to wait 5 or 15 minutes. This device, if you switch it on from cold, could take you 2 or 3 days before you get a frequency that you can really trust. It'll display the time on the front panel very quickly because it only needs a few time samples from the GPS satellites to get your time code from the satellites, where it can give you the date and what have you. But to start steering that crystal oscillator at 10 megahertz and make adjustments, that's a different story altogether. But once you've got it up and running, in theory, you don't switch it off, because you're going to have this issue that if you do switch it off, it's going to take time to re-establish its steering capability or its disciplining capability. I'm roughly speaking, and I'm going to do a demonstration, if it loses satellites, so if you lose lock on satellites, it's not too bad, it'll actually stay fairly stable. The challenge is that when it establishes lock on the satellites again, it then goes through this process of using the ADAC to adjust or steer the crystal oscillator, and then things go out of kilter. But if you've got a warm startup, let's say I switch this off overnight. Often I cannot run this overnight because of my limited power resource. I left it overnight so that at least I can do this demonstration. But if I switch it on, I probably need to wait anywhere between 1 and 3 hours before it's really kind of settled and I've got a 10 megahertz signal that is trustworthy and spot on. But anyway, so what happens? We've got the GPS satellites bringing their signal in. You've got a receiving antenna, and that goes to a microprocessor or CPU. And that is what differentiates these devices, is that microprocessor and the algorithms or code that it runs to do that steering. When we take a look at the cheaper device, you'll realize that it has some certain shortcomings because it obviously doesn't have a lot of intelligence. Now, what the CPU can do, for one, it'll output also a time code format. It's IRIGB or IRIGB. That is one of the standard time codes. So that can be used for sending, let's say, a time code to slave devices or other devices. You can get these devices which have got an RJ45 LAN connection in the back, which are giving NTP, network time protocol, out to servers and computers. So it gives that IRIGB out. That CPU, what it does, it first of all starts to do a lot of averaging with the satellites to get a very good reference signal. It's averaging to get that signal, and it's also taking into account the environment and the temperature, because at the same time it's trying to steer the oscillator towards its reference that it's getting from the satellites. There's also temperature and drift, which are also steering the oscillator. So it's got to account for both. Now, within the specifications of this device, with the standard crystal oscillator, so not the ovenized one, they claim you need to have a conditioned environment that is within about 5 degrees Celsius. They've got certain parameters locked in there, which their algorithm uses to say that I only need to cater for a 5 degree difference. And because if you're trying to cater for a greater temperature range, you've then got a lot more fluctuation that you have to use on the DAC. And when you're starting to make more changes on the DAC, it's like having a trim pot and you're kind of doing this back and forth the whole time. You're not going to get a stable frequency very quickly, and you can introduce things like jitter and phase noise. So that's this like little flutters or changes on your oscillation. You can, however, in the instructions or the manual on this, you can add an external oscillator, and you can add a rubidium standard to this externally and a cesium standard. Heaven knows why you'd want to steer a cesium standard, but you can do with GPS satellites. But if you add an external oscillator, you can specify parameters outside of the norm. So for instance, if I really wanted this to kind of work better in my environment where it's not conditioned and I'm not operating within 5 degrees Celsius, I could specify that I need a 10 degree or a 15 degree range. And you can do that. You can actually enter those parameters, and then it'll allow that greater steering. So that CPU basically is using those reference signals to very accurately get that time pulse, use that 1 second pulse to get precision timing as a steering for your ovenized crystal oscillator. And it does that through a DAC. So what is a DAC? A DAC is a digital to analog converter. And in this case, the DAC inside there is a 16-bit DAC. So a 16-bit DAC means that it's going from -32,768 to 32,767. So what's it, 64,000, you can break up your adjustment range into over 60,000 little small adjustments. And it's using that to control, it's got an electronic tuning circuit with a 10 volt range. So that 10 volt range, and these details become important because although this can calibrate your crystal oscillator indefinitely, they can go outside of that range. And it's something to be wary of when you're buying this older equipment, because it could leave you in a bit of a pickle if your crystal oscillator has aged that much and it's almost outside of that adjustment range. So on this device, you've got two adjustment ranges. One is from 0 volts to minus 10, and the one is from 0 volts to plus 10. And depending on the oscillator that you use, they will have different voltages or different voltage ranges that they used for their steering in terms of doing calibration or adjustment. For instance, I think the one that's in here, the Ovenice crystal oscillator, operates between 0 and 10 volts. If you use a rubidium standard, it actually operates between plus 2.5 to plus 7.5. So it's only got a 5 volt range of operation. And if your rubidium standard drifts outside of that range, so it, first of all, it cannot use the full capability of the 16-bit DAC. You're only using a small part of the range of the, or the capability of that 16-bit DAC. And if your rubidium standard happens to go outside of that range, well, then it has to be sent away to either, you either have to change it, or perhaps they can then do a coarse adjustment to bring it back in line, where you can use the fine adjustment of the 16-bit DAC to then adjust it. But that's what's happening, is that DAC, and we can actually see it when we get to the bench, it'll give you a value between those two ranges. It'll use those fine adjustments on the DAC to the electronic tuning circuit. Now, they call it the electronic tuning circuit. You also get voltage controlled DACs, where you can adjust the voltage to finely tune the frequency of the crystal oscillator. So as this is changing or being affected by either temperature or aging drift, the algorithm here is taking account of that. And it's then sending a digital signal to the DAC, which is then converted to an analog voltage, which is used to control and tune that crystal oscillator. And because it's got all this intelligence, it can show you those parameters. It can actually, once it's actually established the reference frequency, so once it's managed to steer the crystal oscillator to your reference, which it's getting from the satellites, it can then also calculate the drift of the oscillator, which is really handy because then it starts to learn the characteristics. And basically, if it then loses connection with the satellites, it can go, so based on my last information, the drift was happening at this rate per day, and we're talking about parts per million, parts per billion, parts per trillion. So when you start getting to let's say a standard crystal oscillator, you might have a drift which goes down to parts per million per day. An ovenized crystal oscillator might be parts per billion, and then a rubidium standard will go to parts per trillion. And in fact, when I was looking up the spec of the cesium, they didn't even quote it, because obviously there's so little drift, or it virtually doesn't drift, that you don't have to worry about it. But it can then understand the characteristics. And the fascinating thing is, or the one thing I couldn't understand, which I think I understand now, is that once it, let's say it loses connection with the satellites, even though it understands the characteristics of the crystal oscillator, it will show you on the display the potential error you're going to incur with your measurements, which is quite handy. So you can actually see over time, let's say you don't have access to the satellites for several days, it'll then keep track and say, well, your time is out by so many nanoseconds or microseconds, or it might get down to milliseconds. From my calculations, looking at the specifications, if I've got it right, even if this doesn't have input from satellites, it'll only lose milliseconds in a year. So it remains a really accurate source even without the satellites. And what I kind of left this on overnight, looking to see whether the DAC would actually make some adjustments when it didn't have connection to the satellites, and it didn't. And the only logic I can do there is that if your environment happens to change, you're going to change the characteristics of that aging and the drift, which is going to be different from what the CPU has memorized. So it might be a compromise trying to make those adjustments if something else changes, and then it might throw things right out of whack. But as I said, what I'm going to demonstrate, the challenge is that when you then get this, when you then start receiving the satellite signals, it then starts making some quite wide swings to bring it back in line, and that creates a fair bit of noise and misadjustment before it starts to slowly come bring itself back. And I say, that's one of the challenges I want to show you, the expensive unit versus the cheaper unit. That is how a GPS disciplined crystal oscillator works. Once you get that reference frequency, it can then use a frequency divider, and on here you can see it's got, on my one has a divide by 10 to give you 1 megahertz. You've got the 10 megahertz out. It's also got a divide by 2 to give you 5 megahertz. This 1 megahertz out I find particularly useful, because if I'm making adjustments or referencing something on the frequency counter, if I'm using a 1 megahertz signal, I've got more resolution. Because of the 10 megahertz signal, I've got fewer digits I can use because I've got the 10. If I drop the 1 and I'm down to 1 megahertz, I've got more digits, so I can have more resolution when I'm trying to measure something on the actual frequency counter. I cannot use that 1 megahertz as a reference though. I need to use the 10 megahertz as a reference in the back. So as noted, you've got something, if you are looking into this, you're going to note, have something called Allen variance or deviation, and that's particular to crystal oscillators in terms of their immediate stability or accuracy over 1 second, 10 seconds, 100 seconds, or even a day. Because when you're doing those fine measurements, you are going to have certain stability or accuracy that you need to take into account. And for, as I recall, for this device, with a standard crystal oscillator, it is going to go down to 3 to 10 to the minus 12. Now, when you get these figures, you need to multiply that. If you want to get a kind of meaningful reference in terms of time or frequency, you have to multiply that by your reference frequency, whatever that is. Now, in this case, it's 10 megahertz. So if you go and multiply that 3 by 10 to the minus 12, times your reference, that comes down to 0.00003 hertz, and that is within a day. So although you will have numbers for 1 second, 10 seconds, 100 seconds, I took that reference for a day. So that was for the standard crystal oscillator. The ovenized crystal oscillator that I've got takes that down to 1 times 10 to the minus 12, as opposed to 3. And then if we're looking at, so that is accuracy and stability. If we're looking at drift and aging over time, and that can, I say, can be measured in by the day, month, or year, they give a figure of 2 times 10 to the minus 6, and I think that must be a year for the internal oscillator. They don't actually give a time reference, which they should, but the ovenized crystal reference that I've got in here, that will give you 1 by 10 to the minus 10. Which is 1 millihertz in a day. So the ovenized crystal oscillator, if it doesn't have the GPS satellites to keep it tuned or calibrated into the reference signal, it can drift by 1 millihertz per day. Anyway, let's get down to the bench and actually have a look at how it operates.